Hey, Dr. Stihu with you. So let's talk about the 7 best vitamins for hypothyroidism. This is a cool topic I'm really excited to go into. So hypothyroidism is something that's really common and a lot of people suffer with, and it's tough to find solutions. And I think about solutions in categories. There's some that are easy to do and easy to figure out. There's others that are things you can do on your own, but not always all that easy, like diet and some lifestyle changes. And there's things that are pretty complicated, like looking at the secondary conditions that cause it or getting the medications just right. These are things that take a fair amount of insight and perspective and some guidance and some help. So there's kind of a hierarchy. And it's not to say that pills solve all problems, definitely not, but they are the easier part of the solutions. You take them, you know, and they can help the chemistry in various ways. So in this video, I'll talk through hypothyroidism, you know, what it is, what it means, how do you know if you have it, and then about what's out for treatment options and focusing on some of those that are non-prescription and pill-based. So for starters, what is hypothyroidism? Well, there's different ways to answer that. There's like proper definitions, there's the way we use this in common language, and there's formal medical categories, and I'll cover all of those. So popular definitions, we think about really just too little thyroid hormone. And there's a lot of symptoms that can be associated with that. Classic ones are always going to be the weight, the fatigue, the hair thinning, but there can be many others. We know that thyroid hormones affect every cell in the body, head to toe. And that's not true of other hormones. So yeah, we can see digestive symptoms, dry skin, menstrual irregularities, mood changes, movement problems, changes in organ function. Anything you can shake a stick at can be worsened by hypothyroidism. Now, that's kind of a broad definition. There's also ways it's used more formally. So in the medical world, they define hypothyroidism or overt hypothyroidism as an elevated TSH and a low T4. Symptoms aren't necessary for that diagnosis. They're often there. The next category they have is subclinical hypothyroidism. That's also elevated TSH, but normal T4. Same thing. Symptoms are optional. Now, I want you to hear me. This is not me saying that only these categories can have symptoms and only these categories need help. I'm not saying that at all. But when I talk later on about other treatments, these categories are relevant in terms of when medications help. In fact, I'll mention that briefly now. So those that have overt hypothyroidism, their TSH is way above range and their T4 has dropped well below range, sometimes medications help. Those that have subclinical disease where the T4 hasn't dropped off, or even more broadly, those who have what we call suboptimal disease. Their TSH is normal, but it's not great, or their T3 is low optimal, T4 is low optimal, reverse T3 is high, basal body temperature is low, Achilles reflex is low, they've got relevant symptoms. That's used in a lot of ways, this suboptimal thyroid function. And it's real. There's a lot of ways you can look at it that are not formal disease, but still affecting people. So it's a real thing. But it's an earlier stage of subclinical disease. It's subclinical disease, the problem is more progressed. Now, I say that because we've got a lot of data saying that medications are really hit or miss with subclinical disease and suboptimal disease. So sometimes they can help, but more often than not, they don't. And when people are looked at as groups, those on medications, the groups don't have better quality of life scores, they don't have lower disease risks, and they don't have fewer symptoms. So there are certainly individuals that can be benefited, but it's kind of a hit or miss thing. And if you're someone to where you've been just playing the game, trying to get the meds right, you know, which one, which amount, it might be a losing game. It may not be that you're playing the game wrong. It may not be that it's maybe the case that you're just not in a category that was going to respond to medications. And a little more nuance, medications helping, you got to pull that apart because sometimes when you first go on them, you can feel good in ways that don't last. And that's not the medication helping. That's just getting a buzz short term until your body fights it. And then the other thing is that you may feel worse when you stop taking them. And that's also not the same as medication helping. That's just your body going through some transition, which might take weeks or months. So yeah, just thinking that through, the medications may need to be dialed in. They may need to be changed from one type to another. They may need to get the doses right. They may need to be better absorbed. It's all possible, but it's also quite common that they just won't help. So there, that's why I'm excited to talk about other natural options for this. So when I wrote the thyroid reset diet, I was pouring through all the medical literature I could find on, you know, lifestyle, natural treatment, and thyroid disease. And in doing so, I was looking at food options, focusing on that. But foods are, you know, whole foods, but there's also phytonutrients. There's also vitamins and minerals, and there's like fiber derivatives. So there's all these things you could collectively call nutraceuticals. You know, I'm going to call them vitamins here to keep it simple, but it is a different term. But yeah, all these things together themselves had a lot of really good studies. And I kept finding studies showing that some of these things would make big differences for hypothyroidism. And when we look at studies, there's ways that they can be more or less meaningful. You know, when they're actually about humans, when they're measuring important outcomes, when they've got a placebo arm to the study, it's good data, you know, and it's actually meaningful. So I was excited to pull together all the high quality studies and see which things could help. Another thought process was there's some things that are helpful, but are probably, they probably just belong in a multivitamin. You know, the amount or the type of nutrient, everyone needs some anyway. So it's good, but it's not really necessary in addition. And not only that, when it is in addition, if it's not done thoughtfully, it can become excessive. And this is weird, but when you get a little more than an ideal dose, it's almost just like too little. Now, of course, a massive overdose can be toxic, but we're not even talking about that. Just like a smidge above ideal, to your body can feel just like too little. So paradoxically, too much of a vitamin can give the same problems as too little of a vitamin. So when I thought about this, I wanted to make a blend that had the things that would really help and do it in a way that would complement an appropriate thyroid multivitamin. So that was all the thought process. And filtering it in those ways, things that had high quality evidence, I came down to 7 essential nutrients. And these include valine, vitamin A, withania, methylsulfonylmethane, riboflavin, folate, and copper. Kind of a mix of categories. We've got some herbs, some amino acids, some functional nutrients, some vitamins, some minerals. But these are the 7 things shown to be clearly beneficial. And collectively, they can benefit by lowering the symptoms of hypothyroidism. They can help the thyroid gland work better. And they can lower the risk of thyroid disease progression. So super good things. Now, who is this applying to? So who is hypothyroid? Well, for starters, anyone has been told they have hypothyroidism. Let's take that at face value. Also, anyone on thyroid medication. That would be why it was given. Those who no longer have a thyroid or part of their thyroid gone, they would be in that category. And those who have been told they have Hashimoto's can be considered this as well. So these are all relevant. And the important point is to really make a big difference with these symptoms and cut the risk of overall disease progression. So the idea is that the right amounts of things can complement one's diet and benefit in these key ways. And I'll briefly mention each one individually and then talk about really how to utilize these as part of your self-care. So vitamin A, this one's pretty neat. This one's had good evidence for making a difference for helping fat mass, objectively decreasing fat mass in those who are hypothyroid, and also improving hair health. And that's neat. There's a couple of facets to it. So there's a phase called anagen, which is basically hair growth. Vitamin A elevates anagen. It helps speed it up. And also, it makes a difference for increased stem cells that produce new follicles. Now, I want to say what I said before about like this narrow range, that applies a lot to vitamin A. There's way too much is bad. And a little too much is useless. But the right amount is awesome. The right amount can make a big difference in those ways for fat loss and for hair health. Next up is riboflavin. Now, this is good old vitamin B2. The main relevance here is that the thyroid needs antioxidants. The thyroid is handling iodine. Iodine is like the biggest free radical that circulates in the body. So the thyroid's got to handle it delicately. And it must make antioxidants like glutathione and also one called superoxide dismutase. We'll come back to that in a moment. But riboflavin has been shown to be a limiting part of the formation of glutathione within the thyroid. And we've had high quality studies showing that T4 output in a large group of women is associated with riboflavin status. So those who are at the healthier range of that are less apt to be at those later stages of thyroid deficiency. Next up is methyl tetrahydrofolate. That's a long name. So MTHF, this is a version of folate. This is a natural form of synthetic folic acid. This is important. We've seen screening studies showing that adults lower in folate are more apt to have dose-dependent hypothyroidism. Quite simply, the more they're lacking it, the worse their thyroid function is. Now, there's a bit of a paradox with this nutrient because there's a form called folic acid, which is synthetic, and that's all over the place in processed foods and stuff. And paradoxically, it may impair the effects of folate. So consuming a lot of folic acid can be like being folate deficient. So as you're wanting to augment folate, you want to avoid synthetic folic acid. And there's a lot of ways in which people will do various diets that cut out junk food, you know, highly processed food or fortified grains, and they do a lot better. And there's theories about why, you know, this thing in the food or that thing in the food, but really these additives like synthetic folic acid, they're probably the biggest culprits. Next up is copper. This one's neat too. So this is an important part of superoxide dismutase. That's the other internally made antioxidant that goes along with glutathione. And we've got good data showing that healthy copper status is relevant for maintaining good thyroid cell turnover and also the utilization of thyroid hormones after they're released. You know, there's two sides to the whole equation. There's making the hormone and getting it out, and there's using it in the body and getting rid of it properly. And copper is critical for both parts, especially that second part. Now, this comes back to hair also. There's a lot of ways that copper ties into hair health. There's even some defects of copper deficiency that cause dramatically unusual hair. But milder deficiencies can cause early loss of pigmentation in hair. I had a classmate in medical school that he was, you know, 20s, 30s, but just completely gray, completely light colored. And that situation can be caused by moderate levels of copper deficiency, not even severe. And so too with thinning hair and also breaking and unhealthy hair. These can all be mild copper insufficiencies. Now again, copper, vitamin A, all this stuff, you want some, but a ton is not better than the right amounts. So I made this to complement the Thyroid Daily, which is part of the Daily Reset Bundle. So the total amount is good for those who have hypothyroidism, especially those who are noticing issues with their hair health. Next to mention is methyl sulfonyl methane, another big mouthful. We can call this MSM for short. Now, remember I mentioned how thyroid hormones float around the body? A big part of that is being bound up with certain carrier compounds. And an important one is sulfate. So what happens is there's about 80% of the body's total supply of thyroid hormones that's bound up by sulfate at any given point in time. Now, if one has healthy levels of sulfur, sulfate available, those compounds can be freed up. So your body can draw from that. Think of it like the strategic oil reserve. You know, it's kind of like that. You've got a whole bunch there your body can tap into if you're running low elsewhere. And so methyl sulfonyl methane has been shown to make a big difference for helping the body access that strategic oil reserve. And that's the thing, thyroid hormones, there's actually a lot of backup mechanisms your body has before you go kaput. You know, we've got, you know, two lungs and two kidneys and more than we need for a lot of things. It's the same way for thyroid hormones. And one of the ways we do that is by healthy sulfur metabolism. And methyl sulfonyl methane is a big part of that. There's data too showing that sulfur status can benefit the other effects of hypothyroidism, including inflammation, chronic pain, and then free radical damage elsewhere in the body. Now we're on to an amino acid. We're kind of like jumping categories, and that was all on purpose. This one is L-valine. Now, this is a big part of maintaining healthy body composition. In Metabolism Reset, I just harped on and on about waist loss being more important than weight loss, right? So a big part of waist loss is muscle mass. So holding on to muscle mass. And almost everything that goes wrong with age correlates with loss of muscle mass. And so many problems of hypothyroidism do as well. To get deep into this, hypothyroidism doesn't so much cause just scale weight gain, it causes a negative effect upon body composition. So it causes both easier fat growth and easier muscle loss. So valine is a big part of maintaining better muscle integrity. And there's also data showing that it has independent effects upon benefiting active T4 and bound T4 in circulation. So valine directly helps the body use thyroid hormones and it also helps maintain body composition amongst those who are hypothyroid. Last up is withania, withania somnifera. This is a pretty cool plant. It's been called Indian ginseng. Its actual name means smells like a horse, which is kind of funny, but this has had a lot of good human research. And there was a time in which it was thought it may unsafely stimulate the thyroid, and it was actually contraindicated for thyroid patients for that reason. But that was based upon some early animal studies, and larger follow-up human studies showed that was really not the case. So this can help augment thyroid output, but it won't cause someone to go berserk and to push over to the hyperthyroid side. In a recent clinical trial, 90 hypothyroid adults were given withania or placebo. And those on the active form saw clear beneficial changes in TSH, T4, and T3. So all of these things got better. Now, those are the 7 vitamins that help the most. And I talked about their individual effects, but natural things work better as groups, right? So it's fair to think that the collective effects would be even greater. If each could do those things on their own, together they could be only more beneficial for you. So how to utilize this? Well, hypothyroid support comes in a 2-month supply bottle. Normal dosage is 1 capsule daily with food. Those with marked symptoms can safely do 2 capsules daily if needed, but 1 daily is the basal dosage. And that's meant to go along with the thyroid daily, which is the multivitamin, or it in part of the thyroid daily bundle, or daily reset bundle, forgive me, which is the thyroid daily plus the omega pure plus the calcium magnesium. So those 3 in that bundle represent the core base micronutrients for anyone with thyroid disease. You'd want to do thyroid daily and not the bundle if you were vegan and avoiding fish oil products. Fish oil in general is a good thing, but many versions are higher in iodine, so the daily bundle works around that. So yes, 1 daily taken with the thyroid daily bundle, and the duration of this is really, well, there are hypothyroid lab findings or hypothyroid symptoms, which are the most important part. So safe to take until those symptoms clear up. Yeah, best taken an hour after thyroid medication. Like everything, nothing else with thyroid meds, everything is an hour later. Okay. That's it. Those are the 7 best vitamins for hypothyroidism. Dr. Alan Christianson here with you. Take great care. I look forward to talking again really soon. Bye-bye.